why is it that I am focusing so much on making good student stock lessons? A part of that comes from what I felt was lacking in my own EMR and PC training. The word stock gets thrown around a lot. Stock will see your patients, you just use them for stock. But it wasn't until I started teaching and someone asked me, what is stock? I realized there's actually a good answer for them. And that's when I realized that a lot of, although it is discussed a lot in terms of one of the things we need to watch and inform and treat and is a critical thing for us to treat, it's not usually taught very well. And I felt that once I realized that, it kind of made me think, hey, how many patients who have been in severe early stages of shock have I had that I haven't treated effectively and that I haven't given them the proper sense of urgency at the hospital when I hand them over? And all of that then is to the detriment of patients. The more you learn about it, the more you realize, oh my God, this is a simple concept. But if I don't do the simple things, it can be really bad for my patients. So because of that, I've been trying to put together something that will not only help you to understand what to look for, what to do, but also what kind of patients you're likely to see this in, so you can kind of get a jump maybe a little earlier on anticipating it and have that in your head so that you're not going to miss some of those subtle signs. So first of all, thanks. This is the key points talk. A quick assessment and treatment model. And then once all that's in place, then we're going to go back and talk about the pathophysiology, the disease process of shock. What are the types of shock? Where does it come from? Because although it is fairly simple as something that we look for, there's some complicated things going on in the body that create this. So our key points. Number one, shock is a blood pressure problem. It's not entirely true. So when you talk about shock, you look it up, they'll talk a lot about shock as being a perfusion problem. Perfusion refers to the ability of the body to supply, perfuse the vital organs with oxygenated blood. The problem with thinking of it as a perfusion problem is perfusion is actually really hard to identify and to measure. And in order for the body to perfuse the vital organs with blood, it needs enough pressure to deliver it. Blood pressure is something we can measure, we can track, it's really quantifiable and gives us a really, really strong correlation with whether our patient's perfusing the vital organs with oxygenated blood. So although you should be aware that it's a perfusion problem, for the purposes of assessment what you're looking for in your patient, it's a blood pressure problem. Because blood pressure is what we can identify early, we can find it, we can measure it, and that lets us react to it much more quickly. So, shock is a blood pressure problem. Get that in your head, remember it, and depending on how much I'm around, you'll just hear it over and over again. You won't have a choice. My goal is always to say it often enough that when I start saying, shock is a, you go, blood pressure problem, you know? That's my goal. Repetition is the mother of education. Part two, shock is, actually it's reverse. Let's go with this one. Shock is a circulatory system problem. Part three, shock is a circulatory system problem. So blood pressure is the main function of the circulatory system. It's to maintain that pressure to move that oxygenated blood around the body. In order for someone to be in shock, that has failed. So someone may not get enough oxygen because they have a breathing problem, but they're not in shock, right? Shock is a circulatory system problem. And that means some component of the circulatory system is failing. Whether that's the pipes, the arteries that deliver that oxygenated blood, the heart, which looks just like this in your chest, or it should, or the blood, which I've drawn as a drop of water and I have to put blood on. So, fine. Shock.
That's probably not healthy.
It's not healthy. Cardiogenic shock. Spoilers. So, one of these things or more has to be failing for somebody in shock. And again, one or more of these is going to fail, which is going to cause a blood pressure problem. Okay?
So they're kind of one of the same.
Yes. Meaning, sorry.
That
blood pressure is part of the circulatory
system. Yes, exactly. The function of the circulatory system is to maintain blood pressure. Mm-hmm. And it does that by having pipes that are small enough, so the container is small enough for the volume of fluid, by having a pump that moves that blood around and creates that pressure, and having enough fluid in the system to create that pressure. So you think of if you owned an old three-story house. For those of you from Vancouver, houses are things that your grandparents own that you never will. Look it up on YouTube. They're really nice. They're so big. If you have an old three-story house and you've got a bathroom on the third floor, if your pipes aren't good, you're not going to be able to move water to that shower on the third floor. If your pump down in the basement isn't pumping away, you're not going to move water up to the third floor. And if the well's dry, you're just not going to be able to move water up to the third floor.
Is it just blood vessels in general or arteries?
So veins do play a role in one particular type of shock, but usually we talk about arteries because arteries are muscular. So arteries are the ones that adjust. So we start looking at how the body is going to compensate for these problems. One way to compensate is by tightening up those arteries and restricting the flow of blood to certain areas. So if you have the same amount of fluid and you've got a good pump, but your container is smaller, your blood pressure is going to go up. And your arteries are what allow that container to get smaller or get bigger a little bit. Okay. Your hand is up. I don't know.
Oh, I was just saying, that's my house, the whole three.
Yeah. Really? Where are you from?
I live in Chilliwack.
The mythical land of Chilliwack. Great. Okay, so back to number two, which should be number three. Already off to a rotten start. Shock is a symptom of another problem. Something is causing somebody to go into shock. If that isn't solved, shock will continue to get worse until that person dies. The only treatment that we can provide, in most cases, the only treatment we can provide is slowing down that process to buy time to get that person to a hospital under the care of a physician who can do doctory stuff and make the problem go away. Right? As is so often the case with emergency medical responders and primary care paramedics, our job is to keep this person alive long enough to make them somebody else's problem. This rarely applies as strongly as it does in someone who's in shock. Okay? There is one exception where we can treat somebody, but that still isn't going to reverse the shock. It's just going to kind of arrest it where it is, and that person can still get sick. So the priority here is to remember, get them to a hospital. Right? These are the most rapid transport. Do you see any indication of shock? Good? Questions on these key points we're going to be building on now? Great. So I need to put a check mark up here. Gave me a great job. Assessment triggered a shock. To begin assessing shock, we understand the stages that it goes through. Let's do this in the framework of, let's put this over here, hypovolemic shock. It's the one that people understand the easiest, at least I do. Hypo for low, volemic for volume, low blood volume shock. What is probably the most likely cause of someone to have low blood volume?
Bleeding.
Yeah, bleeding. Their blood's in the wrong place. Maybe it's in their abdomen, or maybe it's on the wall on the floor over in the next room, but for some reason their blood is not where it's supposed to be, and so you give low blood volume shock. As that fluid gets lower, the other parts of the circulatory system have to begin to compensate to keep that blood pressure up. Okay, so as we discussed, what are the arteries going to do to help compensate? And tighten up. And they're going to start driving that blood toward the core of the body. Right? So, you know, if your body needs to make choices, it's going to say, your hand or your kidneys. And it's going to say, kidneys win. And so it's going to shut down that blood flow a little bit by tightening up those arteries to the hands, to the feet, and also to the outside, to the skin. So, tighten up, which is called vasoconstriction. Again, that only affects the arteries, not the veins. What can the heart do to get this blood pressure up?
Be faster.
It can be faster, it can also be harder. We can't really measure that, but it's good to know that that's what's going on. So So the contraction force is going from a nice, you know, one of these to more like one of these. They're really pushing that blood through, and it's doing it faster to try to keep that up. So at risk of sounding not safe at work, faster, comma, harder. There we go.
Better, faster, stronger.
Sure. Those are probably better words than what I mean. But I think mine are more memorable.
Yep.
So with this stuff happening, at this point, your patient is compensating for this lack of blood. So what are you going to see when you're assessing their vital signs?
Are you going to feel it really, if it's contrary, if it's tightened up, are you going to feel that much extra?
Yeah, because right now, you're compensating. So let's start with the blood pressure itself, right? Blood pressure is not going to be high, but it's probably not going to be low either, or not super low. So a term we use for this is soft. And it's going to be racks and one arrow for blood pressure. It's going down a bit, but it's not going to be super alarming. And that means it's high enough, you're still going to have a radial pulse. But what else do you can see? You can go through the vitals.
Increased rate.
So increased heart rate. And that can get pretty fast. The heart is moving blood around more quickly. Blood needs oxygen wants to fill those oxygen seats. So what else is going to go on?
Breathing
rate. So increase respiratory rate. And this vasoconstriction bringing all this blood to the core, what other vital sign are you likely to change here?
Skin.
And how's it going to look?
Cool and clammy.
Pale, cool, and clammy.
Will you get lower SpO2 readings on extremities?
So don't count on it.
Okay.
And here's the problem with SpO2 and shock, and this is why shock. So if you think someone's in shock, what's your high flow oxygen, or what's your oxygen concentration supposed to be? You think someone's in shock? High flow 15 liters a minute, no matter what the SpO2 says. And the reason for that is SpO2 measures percentage of oxygen saturation, mm-hmm. right? So if I have in any sort of one unit of blood, and these numbers are not accurate, if I have 1,000 red blood cells and 950 of them are with oxygen, what's my oxygen saturation? 95%. If I've lost a bunch of blood, I'm not moving as much blood around, and in the same sort of volume of space, I've got 500 red blood cells. Not accurate. You'd be dead. 500 red blood cells and 475 of them have oxygen. What's my O2 saturation? 95%. Massive stuff. Up here, do we really care that much about these other 50 red blood cells? No. Do we care about these other 25 down here? No. Very much so. Your SpO2 monitor is not accurate in shock because it measures percentage and does not take into account the actual volume of red blood cells in there. Right? It's also why it's so bad, or so unreliable people with anemia who like have so low count of red blood cells normally. So if you have this on the stock, we're going to give high flow oxygen no matter what, because your oxygen saturation is going to go from it looks fine to question mark is what you got.
Do we administer or do you get SpO2 check when they're
being
in shock? Sorry. Like if we know that they're in shock, do we do the SpO2 monitor?
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely. So you see what you get. It's really nice to have an oxygen saturation on the mirror if you can get it. Don't ignore it, but it's a bit of a random number generator with that one. Okay. Now, also another reason for it is kind of nice to know if you're going to get a number at all. So if you don't get one, that tells you you're completely shut down. Another one here is anxious. Probably not confused, Brain's still being perfused. Like, we're compensating. So we're still delivering enough oxygen blood to the brain because we're compensating. But, like, brain knows something's not going right. So the brain is going to, it's going to be a little worked up, a little bit anxious. Okay. I'll say it for a few minutes, but I've got a really good story about that with a friend of mine that did a call. And it has really kind of drove this home for both of us at the end of the call, what this actually looks like.
So, I don't know if this goes further than we're trying for, but assuming, like, we're saying RDS, and assuming, like, we're looking for the rate of low blood volume, assuming the person is not actively bleeding, will there be signs during the RDS that we're seeing for internal hemorrhaging?
Yeah, let me throw that back to you. What kind of things would make you think this person may have an internal bleed?
Hard spots in the abdomen?
Yeah, or just generally rigid or abdominal pain. Take a look at that abdomen. Look for bruising on the abdomen itself. This has been going on for a while. It makes you bruising kind of striated across the abdomen. But that's a really late sign. You shouldn't count on it. More like, where's that direct trauma? So of the four quadrants of the abdomen, where's the biggest risk is for internal bleeding? Spleen, and where is that? Upper left. So any kind of bruising on the upper left with a decrease in pulse strength, things like that, should make you automatically jump to that. Because here's the thing, this stuff can be super, super subtle. If you may have like a blood pressure of 98 over 70 and a heart rate of 108. Is this like you be and person kind of anxious, worked up, you expect the heart rate to be a little high anyway. Blood pressure's a little low, heart rate's a little high, but like skin condition is kinda okay. Right, really no big indication. This kind of thing is really easy to miss, and I say that because I know I've missed it many times over the years before I really got my head around this. A good indication of identifying someone's in shock generally is if their heart rate is higher than their systolic blood pressure, treat them for shock. Okay. This means you're probably over-treating shock a little bit. Treating some people maybe don't necessarily need it. But you know what? It's not being bad for them. Now, it comes back to this often as people say, well, there's lots of reasons for the heart rate to be high besides shock. And maybe their heart rate's high because they're upset, because they're anxious, because they're in pain, all of those things. But if your heart rate is high, what should be happening to your blood pressure? It should also be going up with that increased heart rate, right? There's a reason why when your dad was screaming at you when you were a kid, your mom said, watch your blood pressure. It's because your heart rate goes up, and so does the blood pressure goes along with it as well, okay? Maybe my bad. So, the problem with compensated shock is, number one, if the underlying problem hasn't been solved, it gets harder and harder and harder to compensate. And so eventually you just run up. And part of the compensation takes energy. But where's the energy come from? It's gotten delivered in the blood. Well, it's harder and harder to deliver blood. It takes more energy to deliver less oxygen in blood. Eventually this is gonna fail. Even if we can solve the problem, so think of your amputated arm, you put a tourniquet on, you solve the underlying problem, this person is still in shock, and it still takes energy to compensate, and eventually that is going to run out. So we need to be aware of when that change happens and see what we're going to look for. Thinking of our compensation mechanisms here, what's going to change as we move into decompensated shock? Consciousness. I love that this is the one that came out first, because this is going to be your first indication that this has changed. You're taking vitals every 5 minutes, right? But you're probably talking to and looking at your patient the whole time. And when you see them, it's kind of like, starting to drag, starting to get really drowsy, starting to fade. It's like, hey, where are you from? I'm like, ah, I don't know. I can't. Oh, something's changed. Let's get back on those vitals again, right? So decrease LOC. There's no longer alert and oriented times. What else can change? Blood pressure. Blood pressure is going to drop into the roots. I remember when I was first learning, they always talked about 90 as a magic number. if the systolic drops below 90, this person is in decompensated shock. It's really not that specific. Forgot about that for like just like 5 minutes, and now I'm aware that it's there. Because everybody's just fine, I'm just holding it, but it's just fine. So rather than having a specific number, because here's the thing, someone who is young, fit, slim may have a normal blood pressure in the low 90s anyway. A drop to 88 isn't really going to affect them very much. That pulse, that's your big one. That when that pulse disappears, they are in decompensated shock now, right? They probably went in there a little bit earlier, but this is your last best sign of that. Okay? So keeping on that radial pulse.
I chatted with my girlfriend about it, and she mentioned that as soon as BP drops below 20, it's a 20-point drop.
Right.
That is maybe as a sign that they're either going pass up or they're in shock.
I would be very concerned if someone BP drop by 20 points. Yes, absolutely. My problem with that is like, it's not a problem with that. Is do you remember the nurse?
She's PCP.
PCP, okay. My problem with using that as your main marker though, is in a trauma patient in particular, you're not doing your first set of vitals after you leave the scene. And then your second set of vitals is 5 minutes later. Right? So let's consider that then our next sign is like this big multiples of 10-point drop in blood pressure. But you should be able to catch it earlier than that by seeing these other complications. Okay. No radial, bad. And if you have extra people on ambulance with you and you're concerned about this, something to assign out, and it feels like this very pedestrian thing, but it absolutely isn't, is, hey, firefighter, I'm glad you're with me. What I want you to do is I want you to put your hand on this patient's radial pulse, and if you lose that pulse, you tell me right away. Now you've got somebody whose job is strictly to measure, has this change happened? And you catch it really early. What else? All of these things take energy.
Sugar? Blood sugar?
Possibly, yeah. But blood sugar could drop. Yeah. Probably not in hypoglycemia, but it could.
Maybe the respiratory rate drops.
Yes. Respiratory rate drops. Heart rate starts to drop as well. Right? So you get this curve where the heart rate goes up because I'm working really hard, but now it's just running out of steam and it begins to drop down again. So you get this level of consciousness. They're going to be super low-key, their skin looks, the technical term is like crap, pale, cool, clammy, because gray, sweaty, cold, some cyanosis of the lip starts to appear, things like that. And that's despite your oxygen, because they just don't have the oxygen-carrying capacity in the circulatory system anymore. Okay? So respiratory rate drops, heart rate drops, skin becomes bad, very bad. There we go, very bad, right? The next phase is not something that we're gonna be able to track, but it's good to know about, because once again, just is our main point with this patient is to slow things down, but speed things up. We need to get them to a hospital. Eventually, your decompensated shock becomes irreversible. And what that means is the organs begin to fail, typically beginning with the kidneys. And once they get into this phase, it doesn't matter if you get them to the best trauma bay in the country, this person is going to die. You pass the point of return. There's a bunch of changes that happen. Again, it's not stuff that we're going to be able to track. We're not going to be able to see it. So if you have somebody in decompensated shock, your job is to waste no time to give them the best chance possible by, once again, making them somebody else's problem. Good? Great. What are you going to do about it? Drag real fast. What else?
Try to keep them calm.
Yeah, good luck. but yeah, you know, I'm not going to write that down, even though like it's a really key thing. A friend of mine, an HCP practice educator, she likes to say, comfort care is primary care. Be nice. Be calm. Be professional. It makes people feel like they're being taken care of well. When those of you who did the first aid course with me, one of the things I was with first aid to make really clear is, like, when you're doing a treatment, make it look good. Look good, feel good. Like if you put a splint in somebody and it looks bad, their pain is going to go up because it doesn't look like they're cared for. They feel like they're cared for. It's a real thing. Do things right. Do things professional. What else?
So what was that saying? Comfort care.
Comfort care is primary care. Yeah, so no, we're not doing compressions unless we lose carotid pulse, like, just like cardiac arrest, like normal. But let's look at the first one. So you said keep them warm, right? Anyone ever done like an OFA1 or like a 7-hour emergency aid course once in a while, right? I've done those courses. Like there's seven hours of my life I never get back. But there's one thing that everyone walks away from that. It's like, no matter who your patient is, take that blanket, toss it on your patient. Right? And that's kind of where it goes. And that's kind of a shame that's where the conversation stops. Because that blanket, that's maybe let's cut off a little. That blanket does a lot of heavy lifting. Blood moves feet around. There's something called the trauma triad. I'm not going to, like, you don't need to remember it, but what I think you should probably remember. If, as patients get colder, blood clots are more difficult to form, so it's more difficult to control internal bleeding, and you begin to see some changes to the pH of the body. The pH is like the lost vital sign. We don't take it, we don't talk about it, we don't think about it, but we live in a super narrow range of pH, and once that starts to change, things go bad very quickly. The one of those things that we can really control here, though, is heat. If you have a trauma patient whose body temperature is allowed to drop at all, a shock and trauma patient, whose body temperature will drop at all, the chance of them dying goes up by 270%. So that blanket does a lot of work. You know what else does a lot of work? The heater in your ambulance. Ambulances are built for neither comfort nor for speed. But they are very good at two things. They get very hot and they get very cold. With these patients, any trauma patient or anybody who's suspected of being in shock, if you are comfortable in your ambulance, it is too cold. You need this to be warm enough. If your patient says to you, is it pretty hot in here? Can we turn the heat down? Nice, you've done your job. Like, turn it down a little, make them comfortable. But if anything, we want to overdo this because we need to keep them warm. And big thing about these trauma patients too, you're in your ambulance, their clothes are coming off, right? You need to do a full head-to-toe proper assessment, and you need to trauma strip them. Then you put a blanket back over the top, but they're still not wearing clothes, so that needs to be hot. Catherine.
Do they have those tubes with the hot air?
In the ambulance?
Yeah.
Oh, you overestimate what our problem is. No, we have those, like, the vents are in the top, and they blow, and they can all be directed. It's like six each side, I think, six vents, and they can all be directed right onto the patient, and it just blows like incredibly hot air. Or cold air.
Are the different sections of the ambulance somewhat out of control? Like, you have your window open and
blast
the heat in the back?
Yeah, there's a separator between them. Which is great because like Amanda's my most common partner and like she talks to her patients and she's really friendly. Sometimes I've been 12 hours, I don't want to hear that. close the window and turn on AC/DC and away we go. Treatment. So number one, warm. If you don't keep your patient warm, you are not treating your patient. This is a critical intervention. If you want more of an incentive than your patient might die, if you do not keep your shock patients warm in your exam, it is a 100% fail. So that blanket, don't forget the blanket. Blanket's on, place there, right? We just want a blanket. Two, we mentioned already, what are all of these patients gonna get in the primary survey?
Oxygen,
high flow oxygen. Generally with an non-breathing mask. Maybe when they get like deep and decompensated, you may like lose that breathing rate and have to start ventilating them, but typically not. Typically it's just gonna be high flow oxygen, non-breathing mask. And then there's a basic trauma treatment. For people with major trauma, get high flow oxygen. One more, going back to that mythical house that I don't know, but you do, which is awesome. Did not expect to digress in this direction. I wanted to know so much about your house. So the bathroom on the third floor, we don't have water pressure for the shower. Where are we going to go have a shower?
Basement,
main floor. Main floor or basement, sure. Right. So this analogy is getting a little tortuous, I realize. But the same kind of thing wants to happen, we need to happen here. The most important part of the body that needs to be perfused and to receive this blood is the brain. We need to get it.
You want them supine?
You want them supine. So I'm going to use the word horizontal because recovery position is fine too. Mm-hmm. As long as we're not working extra, making the body work hard to move uphill, just keep them horizontal. If their level of consciousness though is decreased, recovery position, three-quarter prone, remains the position that keeps on giving. So horizontal. And then as I said, drive real fast.
Diesel therapy.
Yes.
25 kilometers
over the coast of Canada.
But then ALS doesn't have it, right?
They do have it. Everybody has it.
Oh.
Yeah. Everybody has it.
I've seen an ALS like, rip through low.
Yes, they definitely shouldn't do that. That's because the only group of people who think that they are more important than PCPs are ACPs. and it's almost never that important. I highly recommend that you do not take that as your guide in your body. Trying to think of how many calls have we gone to that another 3 minutes would have made a difference? Yeah, I can't think of any. I think definitely zero. Great. So,
question: Would this be like? Could you call for airlift? Is that a thing?
Absolutely, depending where you are, for sure. And this would be an excellent call. So those kind of policies will be handled when you're hired. Mm-hmm. They're agency specific. But yeah, there's an ambulance process with the ambulance service. So for example, I worked in Bowen Island. Part of my training, my introduction to that station was, where does the helicopter land during the day? Where does it land at night? Because there's two different places. Mm-hmm. And learning kind of what goes off. And how long they take. It is weather dependent though. So keep that in mind. Good. Questions? Good. Okay, so once again, three main points. Shock is what kind of problem? Shock is a symptom of another problem. Can we reverse shock?
No.
No. Who can reverse shock?
Doctors.
Doctors, maybe. I don't know. I don't think about what doctors do. And what system is being involved?
Circulatory.
It is a circulatory system problem. If we suspect someone is in shock, four things we're going to do.
Keep them warm.
Keep them warm. Hypoxia. Horizontal and dry fast. Right? And all of that, guys, you need to be, with these patients, you need to be off scene in 10 minutes with all the stuff in place, no matter how badly they're hurt. Like if this is a complex package, it doesn't matter. You have to be off scene in 10 minutes with these patients. So part of what we're gonna be doing over the next week and a half is making sure that you have lots of practice moving people out of some awkward positions. I don't wanna spoil any surprises, but there are cars in the basement, a parking lot, that have been put into practice for this kind of thing, so that you can be well-practiced working in teams, moving people, and getting going in 10 minutes or less.
Maybe a very dumb question, but do you have cardiac arrest and
shock? Oh yeah, 100%. Well, shock will lead to cardiac arrest, right? Okay. And here's the thing, like if shock leads to cardiac arrest, your CPR is probably going to be ineffective. Right? And then that doesn't mean you're not going to try, not going to follow your protocols, not going to give it your all. But if you have someone who is in cardiac arrest because of shock following a trauma in particular, you need to get in your head that if this doesn't work, this that's not you. That's not.
So if obviously, like, you have a shock patient, can
it
be all the way and go into cardiac arrest?
Yeah, now you're just running a cardiac arrest. This is a good one to vary a little from like the strict ones. If you think about it, this is a good one to make that call to impairment specialists early, or EPOS early, to say, hey, I would like, this is my location, this is the nearest hospital, I am considering transporting while continuing CPR on route instead of pulling all this out of the road. Because if you're within 10 minutes of a trauma hospital, or any hospital, it's better to continue going. A little bit of sacrifice to your compression effectiveness, but like this isn't going to get fixed inside of the road.
In my line of work, sorry.
Yeah. No, go, yeah.
Where you make your money as a medic is in the first 5 to 10 minutes. All the training you put people through, especially in the military, you're dealing with something like a complex trauma, you make your money in the first 5 to 10 minutes. Someone, because of the how severe the trauma is, regardless of the cause, if it's so severe, most people will die within the first 2 to 5 minutes after an injury. If they're alive at the 10-minute point, that's the golden space where you make the biggest difference in someone's survivability. So when we talk about oxygen, when we talk about blankets, when we talk about getting them going, if they're sort of in that sort of around the 10-minute mark, they're still alive. If you can get them onto the operating table in 60 minutes or less, their probability of survival goes way up. So when we talk about being on the road and getting to the hospital as promptly as you can and not dithering on scene, this is why it makes the biggest difference. So, like, and the reason we talk about this is my number, is that if someone's going to die, it doesn't matter how many more blankets you put on, or, you know, they're going to die. So it's one of the things that when you walk onto a scene, considering the mechanism of injury, it's a good thing to keep in the back of your head that depending on how complex or how severe the trauma is, keep in the back of your mind that you're probably going to have someone who's in really poor condition, and they're probably, especially, you know, it doesn't take long to get into decompensated or irreversible shock, depending on how much they've bled out, how like, traumatic things are. And I mean, if you end up with someone who goes into a traumatic cardiac arrest, which is kind of on the low end there, there's something wrong with the system. And we're dealing with a young person who's drowned, or a young person who's electrocuted, or an old person who has like just a heart failure. The system, generally speaking, is intact. All the parts are there. When you start dealing with trauma, there might be missing parts of the, you know, the plumbing. They might be missing part of the heart because there's like penetrating the injury from a knife or from a tree or something like that. So just, it's one of the things that diesel therapy and getting them there is going to make the difference. So I get really like initiating transport early. So like where we make our money is in that first 10 minutes on scene. That's why they pay us. They pay you, but they pay you.
Good correction. Beautifully said. So the camera's over here, though. Use more. Yeah, really, that's great. Yeah, man, that's really well said.
But nowadays, considering the traffic conditions,
yep,
so bad in Vancouver, like yesterday on the way to the class, there were 2 accidents on the highway, and then the fire truck, the ambulance, all jammed.
Yeah, and that happens. More likely on the highway than on the streets where we can go around things a lot more easily. We don't, license sirens don't give you very much advantage on the highway. You're, because you get 25 kilometers of speed limit. I've been to a license siren that people pass me. You douchebag.
Yeah, that's like enraging to see an ambulance, people not responding.
Yeah.
It's like,
so,
it's
but there's something about that though as well though, is keep in mind on the highway, next time you see those lights in your mirror, pay attention to how long it takes you to hear the siren.
Yeah, I get that,
right?
But like it is quite amazing to see people not slow down and pull over.
Yeah.
Or
my
favorite people that try to utilize it, get ahead.
Yeah.
Or not. I'm gonna be honest, better respect that a little bit. Like they kinda like go into the jet stream of the ambulance. I can see them in there and like, man. It's kinda like, yeah, but also smooth.
So you could be treating someone with what could be quite a minor injury.
Yeah.
And they could be in shock.
Yeah,
so
there's a specific type of shock that's going to go along with that one that
yeah.
I want to talk about.
Yeah.
But keep in mind that when you talk about minor injuries, what else is at play?
Right.
So if you're somebody who has had a minor fall and they fall on their side, but they're on a bunch of blood thinners. Right? The neck and vision are really, really small, and that's where doing that ABC check and like, oh, like your pulse is really fast and weak. Your skin looks terrible. What? You just took a little fall. Hey, partner, you need blood pressure early, and let's see if we're looking at someone who maybe we need to take a little more seriously.
Right. So how would a small injury like cause shock?
So again, you fall, get a bit of a bleed. But there are lots of blood thinners, the body can't compensate for something small like that. So blood thinners, clotting disorders, anything like that.
But like certain people respond to things differently.
Right, I'm gonna get to that.
Okay,
promise.
Okay,
yeah,
so
yeah.
That's
spoilers.
Different than this. Okay.
Yes. We'll get to it.
Okay.
I promise. can I erase this?
Yeah.
All my hard work. So once again. If we're in shock, we are looking at a pump, pipe, or fluid problem. Okay, one or more of those things. If you're looking at hypovolemic, which we've already talked about, all the blood's in the wrong place, some of the blood's in the wrong place, what's the problem? Pump, pipe, or fluid?
Fluid.
Right? Pump and pipes can compensate that for a while. Let's get some of the easy ones out of the way first. Cardiogenic. And it's right in there. Where's the problem with cardiogenic shock?
Heart.
This is somebody who's having a heart attack. I'm having a heart attack, or they may be in heart failure as well, like in the longer term chronic problem, and go into this. If they do, that is phenomenally bad. Most of the time, we're going to be responding to somebody who is having a heart attack, and you get there, and rather than having a heart attack, where you know they're kind of talking, you know, okay, it's a big one. And you walk in and they look like a wet bag of cement. They're gray, they're just soaked in sweat, they're cold to the touch, they're barely conscious. These are your patients in cardiogenic shock. And a patient there, with one patient whose heart rate, or whose blood pressure was 68 over 40 in person. And that's something with shock. Mostly hypovolemic rather than cardiogenic, but then you get this really narrow blood pressures often. So like hypovolemic may be like 88 for a systolic, but it's like 70 for a diastolic. It's super, super narrow. And that's why that pulse pressure is so weak, because it's only moving that dial a little bit, so you hardly feel that weak of a pulse. Right? So cardiogenic, heart attack, it is a pump problem. This one's a little more difficult to kind of conceptualize, but it's actually pretty simple too. Neurogenic. So neurogenic, we talked earlier about these pipes, how they're always under some tension. That requires a signal from the brain to say quiche cats. And that's just always there. It's kind of like when you stand up and walk around, your abdominal muscles, your shoulder muscles, your leg muscles, they just keep you standing up. You don't really have to think about it. Same kind of thing here, even more so, just involuntarily the brain is always sending the signal to keep a little bit of tension up. If that signal gets interrupted, suddenly those pipes flop open. What would cause that signal to be interrupted?
Spinal injury.
Spinal injury is a big one. Yeah, could be an injury like a direct head trauma. More likely we're looking at something on that highway, on that nervous system highway down the spine. So this is your spinal injury. And that's gonna cause pipe crawl. Some of those pipes flop open. Pump's working fine. Fluid is normal, but we've got this bigger container now to try to move fluid through. So when you have those spinal patients, keep an eye out for that. Keep an eye out for the business talk. Now, what's it gonna change? Not a whole lot. Regular spinal patients are gonna be supine anyway. But like, just being that little bit of extra emphasis, like, hey, we need to get going. Spinal patient by itself is not automatically a rapid transport. But a new spinal patient with spinal shock, they absolutely are. Okay? What else we got? Anaphylactic. What's anaphylaxis?
Multisystem
allergy. So really, really bad allergic reaction, right? If I say anaphylaxis, what do you think of as a problem?
Swelling in the airways.
And here's the thing: for swelling to happen, fluid is moving into those tissues. Where's it coming from?
The other parts of the body?
Which part of the body has all the fluid?
The bloodstream,
the circulatory system. So what happens in anaphylaxis is the arteries get big and floppy, they also get leaky, and you end up losing fluid in it. So with swelling around the airway and the face is the biggest concern, but it can happen to other parts, it will happen to other parts of the body as well. They're just gonna lose fluid. So now you've got pipe problem, and you also have fluid problem. Anaphylaxis is bad, bad, bad. And when we think of anaphylaxis, we always think of that airway problem. It is not necessarily going to be there. We used to, back 7 or 8 years ago, we'd be teaching this course or first aid or anything. It was, epinephrine is a dangerous drug. If you're going to administer epinephrine, make sure that you have a problem with your swallowing. So monitor your anaphylaxis patient until you have an airway problem. When you have an airway problem, administer epinephrine. And that was great. Sometimes. Unless they don't have an airway problem. But their blood pressure is super low. And so what happened, what kind of prompted this change is, what was happening occasionally was, one patient looks super sick, they're sweaty, they're barely conscious, but their airway's fine. So this EpiPen I've got, I'm just gonna hold on to that. You keep on. 2 minutes later, man, so what's your name?
Hawken.
Sorry?
Hawken.
Hawken?
Yes.
Wow. Hawken, well chosen. Hawken is, it's 2 minutes later, and he's like barely conscious, he's looking even worse. I'm really worried about him. Is that ambulance gonna be here? But his airway's fine, so I'm just gonna hold on to this EpiPen in case I need it, okay? A few minutes later, checking it, and okay, he looks terrible. I'm gonna give him this EpiPen, but it's too late because Hawken's dead. Hawken didn't die because of an airway collapse. Hawken died because he was in anaphylactic shock, decompensated, and his heart stopped. And that epinephrine is now not gonna do anything. So now, we really flipped our approach to epinephrine in the first aid world, and that is, Epi early. Hey man, do you get something to eat? Yeah, I'm really. Do you have an allergy to bees? Yeah, I've got my EpiPen here. I'm not sure if I should. Ow! Get consent. Two things are happening. They have an exponential relationship. Anaphylactic shock is very, very bad. If you have access to epinephrine, give it right away. Okay. What else we got? I'm gonna leave obstructive to the last one. Oh, I know, the one that you were talking about. Psychogenic, put that up here. Psychogenic shock. So when we are startled or emotionally disturbed by the sight of something, it causes a temporary vasodilation. Right? Same thing's happening in your neurogenic shock. Vasoconstriction, arteries get smaller, vasodilation, they get bigger. Why does that happen? I'm not a neurologist.
I was like,
sure. I go that far.
I guess like you need more oxygen and blood to get to places you can run away real fast, I guess.
Vasodilation happens when we have an emotional onset. And as you said, different things affect different people in different ways. Some people it's the side of blood. Hopefully no one in here, or you have maybe poor choice. Other people, it may be just like receiving bad news. Hey, we'll sort of tell you your cat got one with a red heart today. And then suddenly this big vasodilation. This is my problem. Temporary vasodilation. It happens in panic attacks as well. Okay, it can happen in panic attacks. Does it December? Oh my god. You sit down, right? If everyone looking at you, like you're pale, you're sweaty, you're anxious, and that's because this vasodilation has put you into a compensated shock. Pipes are bigger, heart has to work faster, right? So your heart rate is going to go up, blood pressure is going to go down. And the key thing about psychogenic shock to remember is this. When we're talking about professional response, by the time we get there, the body should have solved this problem. And you're going to sometimes have a little bit of downward pressure from jaded partners, for example, who kind of look at the profile of your patient and say, this is no big deal. And I'm going to totally resist that, and you probably will initially. Then you'll become a jaded partner, and then you're going to mess up. And then you'll be in my position, sitting down with people, don't mess up. The key here, the key population that is right for this is high school students. You got your 13-year-old high school student who it's exam week, so right away you're getting all this anxiety attack, and they pass out in class. And so on the way there, you and your partner start saying I see what's going on. Anxiety attack, it's exam week. And then you start kind of making plans for what you're going to do after you don't take this person to the hospital. So what high school is that? That's McMahon. Okay. How close is that to the nearest Taco Bell? Okay, perfect. So what's it going to do? however, if you actually arrive on scene and you are still seeing indications of shock, you should strongly suspect there's something else going on. Because this comes on fast, but there's nothing actually wrong with this person. Nothing physiologically wrong with this person. And the body will just fix it. Fast. Pass out, syncopal episode, what this is called, right? Painting spell. End up on the ground. But then the body's like, okay, well, I overreacted. Tighten up those arteries again, once I get the blood moving again. But when you get there, they're probably maybe a little disoriented in that. They don't know what's happened and they're scared, but your vital signs should be fine. If the vital signs are not fine, suspect something else is going on. If the person doesn't feel fine and wants to go to the hospital, take them to the hospital. Don't try to encourage them to stay. Don't try to discourage them from seeking medical care. You do not have the tools to make that decision for them. The only time this person is not going to go to the hospital is if they appear with strong vital pulses, normal warm and dry, normal heart rate and respiratory rate, and they are calm, probably embarrassed, and they are saying, "I am really sorry. I'm fine. I don't want to go to the hospital." And then in that case, are you sure? We're here right now. We can drive. And if they still say no, no problem. Sign our paper. Anything changes, call us back. you know our number. There we go. Okay. That's I'm glad that you brought that up, because in a first aid, like first person on scene, seeing it happen in front of you, yeah, let's get this person down to the ground, let's get the warm, all that stuff. In a professional response scenario, if that hasn't fixed by the time we get there, there's probably something else going on. Good? Yes?
I ended up having a motorcycle accident as a passenger, and I was going around with it and kicked out. And I, like, when I was younger, I saw like somebody spear across the highway from that, and I was like, cheese grater. That's all I ever thought of since.
Wow.
So, like, when it happened, I was sliding, I was like, I don't want to be a cheese grater, and I'm going to mention it. Like, I kicked up as quickly as I could and ran the rest of the way. But then I was like, I was fine, and then I'm like, looking around, there's blood all over me, and I'm like, and I just like collapsed. I was like, okay, like I'm good, but my body had like completely shut down in shock, you know? Like, I'm fine. It's fine. And the firefighters are on scene, and I'm like, I'm okay. Trust me.
I'm fine.
Yeah, like sure everything else was fine, but they, even though like after a couple minutes, like I was good in the sense I could stand up, they still like were like, no, you're going to the hospital because of it. There's also a collision, so they didn't know like what, or like, I didn't know if that was more.
Yeah. It's hard to assess you.
Yeah. But they did all that, and then it was like, in the ambulance, but they did
vitals.
Okay.
It's a position I've been in a lot to do that, and it's great, right? It's great when you get from the back of the ambulance, you can do the vitals, everything's great.
Yeah.
You know what? We're fine.
Is there any situation where that could just continue to progress? Like, I guess with an underlying problem.
So there's where someone has been in an accident, they feel fine. Even maybe you get there and like, I'm fine, I'm just shaking. But maybe, you know, the seatbelt was a little too high on the hips, and they actually came forward, and they've got some internal bleeding going on. That would be the kind of situation where. And then you're doing a different type of shock, and that's not going to become obvious until you get those vitals. Two more types of shock. How long is it?
Sorry, just before we move on, how long does that take?
Five, ten minutes. So my error with this was doing very much the same thing. ALS and called that as well. I was pretty early in my career. You'll go for this this kind of curve in your career. There's a name for it. I'm familiar with it. The Dunning-Kruger curve, where you start and you have no confidence, and you're like everything being done so carefully, and then as you gain confidence, your confidence goes way up, and it kind of peaks at a certain point. Where you're really going to make mistakes, that is called Mount Stupid. And then once that happens, you lose all confidence and abilities, like the curve drops back down again into the pit of despair. And then you have to kind of put all of your experiences together, and you kind of slowly crest back up to the plateau of enlightenment. I was on top of Mount Stupid. We got a call to a bubble tea shop for like a 16-year-old girl who weighed like nothing, who had passed out in the while waiting in line. Walk in, she's laying there, she's still looking pale, still kind of anxious. I didn't even put a hand on her wrist. I just had ALS coming behind me. And I told them, oh no, she's okay, guys. We got this. And like, yeah, you know, we're gonna stick around for a little bit anyway, because and in their minds, it's because we can see you haven't actually done anything, you idiot. Anyway, they put her on the monitor and said she had an underlying cardiac problem. And I was like, oh my God. If it had just been me, I would have just been like, hey, yeah, you feel okay? Yeah, so I had it. Yeah, you're probably fine. Have some bubble tea, get some sugar, and you sign a paper, and went home. And you know what? I never would have known. Never would have known. Really glad it's on camera, also. This is even the date, the bubble tea shop, versus name. Septic shock. What's septic? What does that refer to? Infection. So, infection. You go dive a little bit more into sepsis next week, but as infection gets worse, it becomes a condition of sepsis and eventually septic shock. Septic shock's a bit different. Any idea like what the problem is here with septic shock?
Is it like the blood starts pushing the infection?
Pardon me?
Would
they reduce the heart? So, yeah, that's a different thing. Do you think they get like infected wounds coming back toward the heart? This is a bit different than that. Close, not quite. Yes, that's a part of it. It's not really what we're going to go into in this class, but excellent. So one of the big things that was a very impressive answer, really, for me. So when you have a fever, how does the skin? Could be clammy, warm or hot. How does it look? Give me some powder kind of like around the edge of the mouth and that, but generally more flushed, maybe clammy, warm to the touch. Why? Where's the heat coming from? What moves heat around?
Blood,
right? So what's happening in your sepsis patients is the capillaries are the outside of the body are dilating. And because your body has increased body temperature to make the body more hostile to whatever pathogens in there, but it also now needs to get rid of that heat. So it opens up all of these capillaries all over the body and to move the blood to the outside and wick off that heat. Problem with that is, that's not actually where we need the blood. We need the blood to be in the inside. So as someone progresses through sepsis into septic shock, the problem here is that we still have the same amount of blood, pumps working pretty good, but our pipes are all dilated. It's the ones in the wrong ones are the ones on the outside. And that means we've got less blood that's in the core and able to feed those vital organs, right? And this is really different because when we talk about our core vital signs that are gonna say someone's in shock, pale, cool, clammy skin is such a big one. But these patients don't have that. They have hot, probably flushed, and maybe clammy skin. Right. Any change to your treatment for this patient then?
Maybe not.
Sorry? Maybe not what?
I was gonna say no.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, exactly. Right, let's not little blankets on them. We do not actively cool our septic patients. This is not a heat emergency, like a hyperthermia emergency. This is still like it's a metabolic emergency. We do not, I need to pack them in ice packs, things like that. But we need to give them the opportunity to radiate that heat off. And that can be a little bit counterintuitive because if you have a fever, how do you feel? Cold, you get the chills, right? But still, leave the blankets off, let them kind of wake that heat off, normal temperature in the ambulance, and keep an eye on that body temperature. Renal septic shock, if your work is an EMR, call for an intercept with PCP if it's available. Because this is just a fluid problem, we can start an IV, load them full of saline solution, and give them back to you. And it will solve everything. It's like wild how quickly these patients will turn around. How much blood is in their body normally? Yeah, up to 6 liters. Probably for you, 6 liters, you're a big guy. Four and a half to 6 liters, depending on the size of your patient. I've had patients that just like sucked up 2 full liters of saline solution to get their blood pressure back to normal. But once that happened, they were fine. They went from having a heart rate of 120, really irregular, barely feel it on the radial, hot, flushed skin, barely conscious, and a temperature of like 39.9. 2 liters of fluid, get the hospital, and just sucked up like that. And temperature is down to 37.3, their heart rate's down to 80, they're just talking to us, the blood pressure's fine. And you can get to hospital, and it's kind of neat, because you get to hospital, and like, oh, did you call them with a septic patient? Yes. Where's your septic patient? Or their talking partner? Oh, they look fine. Yes, they are, because I fixed them. The one that we take that we can just like flip it around completely, get to hospital, like our critical patient, just fine. And then, you know, that comes back to bite, and they're like, oh great, waiting room for the next 2 hours.
So that's just for septic, that's not for any of the other ones.
Yeah, it's neurogenic. You could do the same thing, but again, it's strictly a pipe problem. Anaphylactic, you would definitely want. In fact, the only thing. In fact, you know what? Like, if you get BCA intercept for any of them, get BCA intercept for any of them. And hypovolemic, we don't give them too much fluid, but if they've lost the radial pulses, we try to give them that, just get those pulses back. Yeah. It's just like they don't turn around as nicely. The septic patients, they just completely turn around. Good. One more I want to talk about, I promise. It's a bit of a weird one.
Just to double check, septic is pipes and fluid, or just fluid?
Just pipes.
Just pipes.
Just pipes. Obstructive shock. So, obstructive shock is a pipe and fluid problem, but fluid problem is a bit of a weird way. So, heart divided into four chambers. Left side gets heart back, it gets blood back from where?
Lungs.
Lungs, so from pulmonary circulation. And for the right side, then from the systemic circulation. Okay? And that's deoxygenated blood coming back. So it's using. Oh no. This is deoxygenated. And this is oxygenated blood. In order for the pump to work, it has to have enough fluid to actually load and prime that pump. Again, just like any other pump. I had a plumber in class a while ago, and he got so into this conversation, I felt educated by that. These pipes are veins. Veins are very low pressure. For example, what should systolic pressure be for it in the system for normal? If you take someone's blood pressure, what should their systolic pressure be? 80 is diastolic. About 120. Okay? So 120. Right? And that's for your systemic arteries, that's your measure. The pulmonary veins are 20 to 25. Very, very low pressure. And what that means is, if anything builds up pressure in the chest, you're going to end up squeezing and choking those off. Okay? Obstructing the flow of blood back into the heart. That's where the structure soft comes from. The same thing happens if you have just like something in there blocking a part of that. The same problem. We're just not getting enough fluid coming back to be able to push that fluid back out again, and so the pressure drops. Okay. There's a few conditions that can cause this. One is a pulmonary embolism. Abbreviated PE. What's that?
When blood clots end up in your lungs.
Perfect. Blood clots end up in lungs. Not in the lungs specifically, in the pulmonary circulation. So not in the lungs, but in those vessels that are around the lungs, dropping up carbon dioxide and picking up oxygen. Right? They get blocked up with one of these. This is pretty most commonly going to happen to somebody who's not mobile for a while. There's some measures in place to prevent it now, but it still happens both. Like where I see most often is picking somebody up at the airport who's been on a flight, and they've been sitting in that chair, especially at a bit higher risk if they on an international flight and taking advantage of all the free booze, because then they got kind of drunk and they kind of pass out for a few hours, and that'd be really important. And that pressure in the bottom of the legs restricts that blood flow coming back a little bit. I've got an aunt. She lives in Toronto. She's 100 this year. She occasionally flies back and forth. She used to fly back and forth between Duncan and Toronto because she has daughters in both cities. But she's 100. She's riddled with osteoporosis. And so she is terrified of falling. Because if she falls, she will break all of the things. So when she gets onto an airplane for 6 hours, what does she not want to do during that flight?
Get up.
And why would you get up on a plane? Go to the washroom. So her tactic is that she doesn't drink any water for 12 to 18 hours for getting on plane.
Wow.
You see it. So her blood becomes like thick and kind of sludgy, and then she sits with her, she has her bag, and she has her cane, and she has her hat, and she just sits in that chair for 6 hours until she gets where she's going. And her entire family lives in fear every time this happens. Pardon me?
How'd you get to 100?
I think it was just only get to 100, like...
It's pure stubbornness.
Yeah. she went to a doctor about 10 or 12 years ago, and they did an ECG, and they asked her when her last heart attack was. She's had her heart attack. Then you've had so many heart attacks in your life. So pulmonary embolism, loxus, that's kind of the big medical cause of this. Traumatic, and I know in your first aid class we covered this a little bit, you'll cover it more tomorrow. Pneumothorax. Pneumo meaning air, thorax means thoracic cavity, so air in the chest. If you have an injury that damages the wall of the lung, air escapes into the chest cavity and begins to form this bubble that compresses the lung, and as it gets, it's called cleft lung, as that gets bigger, it will put pressure on the heart and on those veins and squeeze those veins closed, preventing the return of blood flow to the heart. Another one, the third one is a cardiac tamponade. Cardiac tamponade. The heart kind of lives in its own little sac here. And if there's injury to the heart itself, this can be called infection as well in a bit of a different way, but you get kind of swelling and fluid shift in this little bag, and as that happens, it can compress that vein where it comes in. It also compresses the heart and stops it from expanding fully and bringing that fluid in. So this is kind of your medical reason for this, and then these are your traumas. And your key here is chest trauma, right? Any chest trauma, keeping an eye out for those signs of shock. Good? Four principles of shock treatment. What are you gonna do for somebody in shock before the end of primary surgery?
Heat, unless they're
heat.
Septic.
High flow O2. What is
it? Unless they're septic.
Unless they're septic, yes. Heat, high flow O2,
horizontal.
Man, 3 H's. Heat, horizontal, high flow O2. Got a new habit in mind.
High speed.
And high speed, 4 H's. This is so good.
Like
great.
Okay. One more question about horizontal. Now we don't practice raising the person's legs anymore?
No, this was called Trendelenburg, or modified Trendelenburg, lifting legs up. So here's the thing about that treatment. There is no clinical evidence that lifting the legs is going to help that person's blood pressure. There's a bunch of other treatments. So these have these shock pants you put on people and would compress like really expensive, really neat pieces of equipment. Yeah, didn't work. but man, do we like a new piece of gear? However, here's the other thing about that. If you have a patient who is in shock, and you're driving and you have nothing else to do, and you decide to raise the legs of that patient, and you just do it with these pressures by just doing that. It's not gonna hurt. And evidence drives everything, but there is so many stories from people saying, look, I had a shock patient, nothing else was working, I could not make any change in them, but when I raise the legs, the blood pressure came up 10 points. Doesn't hurt. So as long as it won't hurt, then you can go ahead. But it is not. There's no evidence to actually support that. Okay. Before I let you go, as an agent, just identify the problem. You guys can ask me all kinds of questions about this little case. So we get called for an opioid overdose, and the only thing we know when we get there, as we're going in to this call, is that they had been also called for an opioid overdose 5 hours earlier in the morning, in the same place, same patient. That's all we know. We arrive, we're met outside by a fire who says, they're fine. They're sitting up and talking. And the fire department says, we were here this morning. Walk in, EMR trained firefighter comes with me. We go in and we see this person sitting on the sofa. They have high flow oxygen on, but not because of any reason. At that time, Richmond Fire didn't use SpO2. Their protocol was put oxygen on everybody. So they have oxygen on, but they're not looking well. And check their pulse, and they have a weak, rapid radial pulse. Check blood pressure, it's a little low. Definitely systolic is lower than the rate. Huh, well that's weird. Patient looking shocky, were called for an opioid overdose. They were called this morning. What else do you want to know?
Track marks?
They smoked. They didn't smoke. Yeah.
Were they resuscitated in the morning?
Yeah. As is normal with first aid and dispatch, patient is not breathing, so they start CPR on.
CPR was done on them 5 hours.
CPR was done on them 5 hours
later.
Yeah. What's their level of consciousness?
They're anxious. They're alert oriented, but they're anxious.
Is it a cardiac trauma, not due to like chest trauma?
Okay. So here's what irritates me most about this. I can see you're on that as well. I think you were on that as well. I didn't see that. I went to the hospital, and when we get to the hospital, we're going in, and like as we're driving, asking these questions, and like everything, and they just called back because they said I just don't feel good. So we get to the hospital and we're going in, and all the pieces are falling into place for me. And they're like, man, we got CPR this morning. Oh, that blood pressure is really low. It's not that low. The heart rate's really high. And I'm going in, and when you go in, you hand me your paper, or you did at the time, and then you wait for the triage nurse to call you. And the triage nurse, I call this guy's name, and I'm like, yeah, that's me. So I go up, and as I'm walking up, the final piece coming in, and she says, what's wrong with the patient? I said, obstructive shock, heart attack, tampon on second degree, CPR 5 hours ago this morning. And she's like, oh, that great, oh, amazing, yeah, trauma bay one, let's go. 1 minute earlier, my answer would have been, You got it in no time. So fine, good for you. I'm done. Any questions about shock? Big thing is, be alert. The subtle, early signs are really, really subtle. Pay attention to your mechanisms, injury, pay attention to your ABCs. And if you're suspecting it, treat it yourself. Drive fast, give them oxygen, keep warm.
Courageous. Courageous. I like that a lot.
Yeah.
At what point would treating for shock, and like specifically in terms of lying someone down, if someone has difficulty breathing, they're fluid in their chest.
Oh yeah, good
question.
Now,
so you're teaching if you're breathing for them,
so
they're going to shock.
I'm gonna put this back in. So you have somebody who has exactly that problem. So maybe it's like hemothorax, blood in their chest instead of an air, causing all these same problems. If someone's blood pressure is low, what can we do about that? Okay, what can we do to actually raise someone's blood pressure?
CPR.
if you can't think of an answer, there's a reason for that.
We
can't do much, do a whole lot either.
Yeah.
Nothing really, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, I'd be fluid. We could try. There's some reason in this case why you wouldn't want to do that, though. If they have fluid in their lungs, we wouldn't want to give them IV fluid. So in this case, we could do it either. So we can't do anything to raise the blood pressure. If their breathing becomes completely ineffective, what can we do about that?
BVM.
Yeah, right? So here's your choice. You've got two problems. If you leave them sitting up, the blood pressure problem gets worse. If you lie them down, this is breathing problem gets worse. But one of those things we can compensate for. Also, is that if you're in that situation, you should probably take a second and pee your pants a little bit, because and just pray, like, please let the hospital be around the corner, because that's a really bad situation. And you're gonna see this with your congestive heart failure patients. Congestive heart failure patients fall in one of two categories. They're either wet and warm, or wet, flushed, and warm, or wet, cold, and bloody. Wet, flushed, and warm is fine. They're okay. They're gonna take them to the hospital, get some prednisone, or get their perfusion adjusted, and they'll have the normal time. Wet, cold, blue with chest congestion, man, like they're in a lot of trouble. Like get those AED pads out and attached, because those patients have a strong possibility of cardiac arrest. And this is a perfect example. You're going to be they're blue. Their blood pressure is in their boots. You've got to get them lying down, but now you've got that risk. Bad news. Anything else? Okay. How long was that? So that was like
1 hour, 21 minutes.
One hour, 21 minutes?
Yeah.
God damn it.